Congressman Jerry Litton believes that a democracy depends on informed people. He also believes our government should be more open and accessible to the people. To better inform you of what is happening in your government, Missouri's 6th District Congressman Jerry Litton invites Washington personalities to come to Missouri each month and join him in an unrehearsed question and answer open to the public town meeting to discuss key issues facing our nation. Dialogue with Litton brings you closer to your government and Washington closer to you.
You know, I've always felt that one of the problems with a representative government is that the people who are representing the people spend too little time with the people they represent. And when that happens, special interest groups get more than their share of representation. A lot of times we send people to Washington, they come back on occasion after having sent out a good many newsletters, make a few speeches, appear on radio and television, make a few more speeches, and go back to Washington convinced that they know how the people think. They don't know how the people think. They've been spending all their time talking. It's awfully hard to listen when your mouth's open. And I think what we really need for representative government is a two-way dialogue between the people that are being represented and those who represent them in Washington. And that's really the purpose of this format here, is to provide the kind of dialogue between the people and those who represent them. Because if we don't have that kind of dialogue, then Washington, D.C. has 435 representatives and the people have none. And that's why I've enjoyed these monthly public town meetings we've had for nearly the last 3 years, because it's given me the opportunity to hear from you, to let you talk to me and let me talk to you, and to create the kind of a two-way dialogue that ought to exist for representative government to properly function. I think the guest that we have today has to be identified as really a representative of the people. He's certainly not a protege of the political bosses. He has to be called a product of the people. He's not the darling of big business. He delights in keeping the politicians guessing. He's one of the most popular mayors in America. He's the candid, colorful, sometimes controversial, usually unpredictable, always popular mayor of Kansas City. Let's welcome Mayor Charles Wheeler.
It's good to be here.
Well, unlike some of our guests, you didn't have far to travel.
No, we're in my city, Kansas City, and I'm delighted to be surrounded by all these neighbors of ours in the 6th Congressional District, whom you represent so capably.
You're very kind, Mayor. Very kind. We have microphones stationed around the room, and we'd like to ask people who have the questions to come forward and give us their name and where they're from. And we never really know what's going to happen with a question and answer here, but you're used to that kind of format.
I like to field questions.
Right here.
Jim Farley. Mayor and I are acquainted. Mayor, I read with interest your announcement that you're a candidate for the vice presidency. Number one, why do you want to be vice president? Number two, what's your platform? And number three, what are your plans for corralling the necessary delegate votes?
Can you do that in 30 seconds, Mayor?
Sure I can.
You've got an hour and a half.
I like brief answers. I want to be vice president because I feel like the mayors have a story to tell the citizens of this nation. I belong to the United States Conference of Mayors. They need someone who's expressed an interest in national office, and I figure my chances are about 20 to 1 right now. First of all, Scoop Jackson's got to get the Democratic nomination because he's the man I want to run with. Second, he's got to beat Gerald Ford. And third, he's got to select me as the person from the Middle West. Now, a platform, you can't talk about a platform in 30 seconds. I'm going to write a little book called My Candidacy, 1976. And you'll find my platform pretty much that of the Democratic Party, which will draw that document in the summer of 76.
You know, I was at a meeting not too long ago, and you're talking about your book, and your wife said she didn't read your first book. Now, if she can read your second book, we're in business.
Well, Marjorie's my severest critic, and I'm trying to make the second book more interesting than the first book.
Got a question right here.
J.L. Wolbright, Breckenridge. Dr. Wheeler may want to make some comments, but I'd like to ask you, Jerry, how you plan to vote on this bilateral quest from Egypt and Israel on the placement of American civilian technicians in the Sinai.
Based on what I have seen, and realizing that Mr. Kissinger has not yet told the Congress all of the particulars of the agreement, I would be prepared to support it based on what I have currently seen. Now, I'm not too excited about our sending 200 technicians there, realizing that this is precisely the way we became involved in the Vietnam conflict. But there are many things that are different in this situation than existed in the Vietnam affair. In the first place, we were not invited by both South and North Vietnam to send our technicians there. In this case, we have been invited by both of the parties, both Egypt and Israel. I think it's indeed a compliment, if you really stop and think about it, that two warring nations, Egypt and Israel, that have been fighting each other down through the years, would have enough confidence in America to permit us to send 200 technicians to monitor both countries. Egypt is willing to sit back and count on the good faith and goodwill and the honesty and integrity of the Americans to monitor any movement of Israel in terms of any advancement they might make on their country and their lives. The same thing is true with Israel. This, indeed, I think, has to be a compliment that these two people would be willing to permit America to be the umpire and the referee in decision-making that means whether or not their country survives and whether or not their people will live. I think we've learned enough from the Vietnam conflict not to permit our presence in that part of the world to move into the kind of a situation we saw in South Vietnam.
The forced busing in Louisville has caused nothing but destruction, bloodshed. Boston has caused death and destruction and bloodshed. Kansas City came very close to having forced busing. Is there going to be any changes? Are you going to fight it in Kansas City? And Congressman, is there anything that you can do to maybe open people's eyes to that maybe this isn't what they want, that it's being forced on them and they don't want it?
Right now we've got a situation that is dispersing minorities throughout the city and impacting on housing policies that have been traditional in Kansas City and made it one of the most segregated of all cities in the United States. The mayor must play a situation like this completely by ear, but I certainly know that the citizenry in Kansas City, Missouri is among the most reasonable in the nation. We take our problems head on. We recently passed a half-cent sales tax by 60% to provide some alternative source of funding for public education. I led that election effort and am very proud of the citizens for looking at public education as the number one problem and priority. And with that attitude, we're going to get on top of this problem.
So I think what should be done is that the people who live in this country ought to have the right to live in Arizona, Florida, Missouri, South, North, East. They should be able to live anywhere they want to live. They should be able to work anywhere they want to work. With that freedom, then I think we ought to see to it that an education is a basic right of every American child, regardless of where he might be born. If he's born in an area that's poor, where the taxing opportunity is not there, he ought to have the same opportunity to develop his mind and his God-given talent as a child born in another area with a better tax base. This is a responsibility of society, to see that every youngster has a quality education regardless of where he lives. And I think that is what should be approached, as opposed to recognizing that there are inequities and we should get buses and force people to live in areas or go to school in areas that they don't wish to go to school in. The logical course of action is more participation, in my opinion, on the state and federal level, a funding of education so as to iron out the inequities that exist in some areas that have more financing available to them than others. That appears to me to be the more logical approach.
Lane Leard from Blue Springs, Missouri. What do you foresee, Jerry, on the oil and energy problem as far as congressional action or presidential action in the 2 or 3 months ahead, and what would you prefer to see it come out as?
I would prefer to see the Republicans and the Democrats and the Congress and the administration working together like reasonable men and spending less time playing politics as they have for the last 19 months. I think we have a unique situation where President Ford was not elected with the people. The Republicans are very concerned and apprehensive as to whether or not he can be elected with the people. And there's a great effort from within the White House, in my opinion, to try to embarrass the Congress and play politics to get Mr. Ford elected in 76. On the other hand, I think the Democrats have been out of power. They're not accustomed to that. They don't like what they've been experiencing with the vetoes that have been occurring. And they, too, have been making efforts, in my opinion, to try to embarrass the president and not be as cooperative as they ought to be. So I'd like to see them sit down like reasonable men and women and come to some kind of agreement and spend less time playing politics. That's all we've been doing for 19 months. There's no other way to get around it. When the Congress can work for 19 months and not pass an energy bill and pass a pay raise and a vacation schedule in 30 minutes, we've got some problems. And that's precisely what's happening. If the decontrol goes off, we're going to see old oil raised from 5 1/4 a barrel to the world market price of $12 to $13 a barrel. Now, old oil represents 60% of the oil in this country. Just think about it. 60% of the oil in this country is going to go up in price from 5 1/4 a barrel to $12 to $13 a barrel. That will raise the cost of energy about $600 per family per year. It'll also raise the cost of food. It'll also raise the cost of the price of the shirt on your back, because it's going to cost more to transport it from the fields to the plant to the store to you. So everything else is going to go up. We're going to take, if the decontrol takes place, it'll take $40 billion out of the pockets of the taxpayers and turn it over to the major oil companies. Now, it's hard to imagine how much $40 billion is, but it's almost twice as much as the $22.8 billion tax rebate that was involved in the congressional action to try to stimulate the economy, put money out in the hands of consumers. It will double inflation. It won't double it, but it'll raise it about 50%. And it'll put about 500,000 to 750,000 people out of work because it's raising inflation. From all of that, the decontrol will only reduce consumption of energy in this country about 1%. And I think the price is just too high to pay.
My question is for both of you gentlemen, what is the chances of continuation of general revenue sharing for the small community and for the large community? And Mayor, you may wish to comment on what it meant to Kansas City and if you people are looking forward to its continuation. And then what is Congress's feeling about continuation?
Very good. I speak very highly of all forms of revenue sharing. I think it's been the great breakthrough in American government in recent years. It involves the concept of sending back your taxpayers' dollars that go to Washington untouched by bureaucratic hands in Washington. And I think as such has gained wide approval from all mayors except in the city of Dallas and all governors. The bill is up for study by Congress at this particular time, and I would hope it would be passed in its original form, because attempts at revision can be interpreted as attempts at defeat. And I don't know what the congressman will say, but revenue sharing has kept us solvent. Without revenue sharing in these inflationary times, we'd be down the tube.
Let me say that in the next few days, I intend to introduce a bill that I've been working on for about a year or so, which you probably will support, at least I hope you will, because it approaches it on this basis, and that is that philosophically I've always believed that the federal government exists only to do what the states can't do. The states are there only to do what the cities can't do. And the cities are there only to do for the people what they can't do individually. We as individuals can't have our own fire department. We can't set up our own sewers and streets and what have you. So I think when we look at it in that way, we have to take a little different look at revenue sharing. Revenue sharing now provides funds not only for the cities and municipalities, which are finding it difficult to raise revenue, mostly because they have to rely on antiquated tax laws that force them to move too heavily on property taxes that are not fair. States, on the other hand, have the full legal authority to raise taxes from almost any way they want to raise them. The legislation that I'll be introducing in a few days shifts the formula of revenue sharing away from the states that can raise revenue and to the cities and municipalities that can't. And I think when we do that, we're realistically approaching the problem on the basis that the federal government should only do for the states and the cities what they can't do for themselves. States, in my opinion, can raise revenue. Cities have difficulty doing it. I think this shift would solve many of the urban problems. And I'll be introducing it in a few days, and we'll see if it flies.
Thank you very much.
I'd like to take a second to put Mr. Litton on the spot. I want to hear you endorse Mayor Wheeler in his campaign for the Veep ship.
I'll tell you what, whenever he endorses me for the Senate, I'll endorse him for Veep.
Say is I'm sure nobody wants to be left standing on the dock when the ship pulls in.
We got out of that one, didn't we? I do want to say, while someone else is coming up to the microphone, that we all have to realize and recognize that it took a great deal of leadership for a Democratic mayor like Charlie Wheeler to put forward the kind of a campaign that probably will bring to Kansas City a national convention of the opposing party. It's tough enough for a Democratic mayor to get a Democratic convention, or a Republican mayor to get a Republican convention. If you can just stop and think, we've got a Democratic mayor that's worked very hard to get the Republican convention in Kansas City, and not many mayors could have done it.
Thank you.
You're in for a treat. If you'll swing around, you'll see.
Charlie, you're in my territory now.
Is she gonna endorse me?
Over my dead body. Mayor Wheeler, I wanna know whether we can really take your vice presidential aspirations seriously when less than 6 months we Kansas Citians saw you and heard you take an oath of office to serve us for 4 years as a mayor. Don't you want to be our mayor? Don't you know what you want to be? Have you solved all the problems in Kansas City? Just what is the theory now that in such a short time you should go on to greener pastures?
Well, of course,
I'm sure glad that's your question.
I wouldn't run for that prestigious office if I didn't think it was going to reflect very well on Kansas City, and that Kansas City was going to be run very well during my campaign. I am serious about it, and Mrs. Snow is aware of the city manager form of government, and she knows Robert Kipp, who is responsible for the administrative nitty-gritty of running the city, and she has as much confidence in him as I do.
How do you answer the fact that the people of Kansas City did not elect Bob Kipp to run this city, but Charles B. Wheeler, Jr.?
Well, I'll tell you the difference, Sarah, is that 4 years ago I was on a hostile council, and now I have a friendly council, so...
Let me comment. I'm sure that there were a few people here who really didn't know what was transpiring. Not many, but a few. Sarah Snow, city councilman, Mayor Wheeler, conducted a very vigorous campaign for the mayor of Kansas City not long ago. And let me say that, Sarah, there are many women in politics, many women holding some offices, some cases because the women Sarah's case because she's a very competent, capable person. And whether Sarah had been elected mayor or Mr. Wheeler had been elected mayor, Kansas City would have been extremely good hands. And I think that the city gained from the kind of a campaign that existed, and I think the people gain when you have two people running for public office, both of which could serve the people well and can articulate the problems and educate the people as to some of the issues that are there. And this is what was taking place here, and I think it's healthy in politics.
Very.
As I understand it, Congressman Litton, there's currently some legislation pending dealing with tax shelters, specifically dealing with real estate investment.
Collecting taxes in this country are designed to gain revenue and at the same time to cause people to do things they might not otherwise want to do, to regulate the economy to some extent, to bring it out of recession and inflation, to encourage investment, to discourage investment, to encourage planning, to discourage planning. So when you do all of those things, when you set up a tax structure to cause people to do things, then it can't be totally fair. Those who are getting the advantage will call it a tax incentive. Those who don't get it call it a tax loophole. And I think it's up to the Congress to try to ascertain whether or not tax incentives that are part of our structure provide the kind of economic benefit to the people they're designed to provide, as opposed to just giving people an opportunity to avoid taxation. So we can't just assume that each of these areas are all loopholes, because sometimes they are designed to cause businesses to invest or not to invest. I do think that the Ways and Means Committee has been negligent in the past two or three years of taking as close a study of some of these tax breaks as they should have. And secondly, I think what we need now is a minimum tax, straight minimum tax, which says that no matter how many loopholes you find, no matter how good a lawyer you have, no matter how many little spots in the law you can detect to avoid taxes, you're going to pay at least this much. I think that ought to be enacted by Congress.
Congressman Litton, I'm concerned about House Bill 41, which sets up the Youth Safety Occupational Act that would set a new agency to govern the safety of youth camps.
Now, that was an interesting vote, and sometimes my staff can't understand why I vote the way I do on occasion. That bill was supported by the Boy Scouts and by the Girl Scouts and by the Women League of Women Voters and by every prominent name group that I can think of. And they wanted to know why I would vote against a bill. That's like voting against motherhood and apple pie. And I voted against it for this reason, and that is that I simply don't think that we should expect the people in Washington to determine safety standards and regulations and government red tape for people running every little boys' camp and girls' camp all over the United States. And I think it's illogical. We've done it with OSHA. We've done it with EPA. We've created one bureaucracy after another. We've forced the businessmen to spend too much time filling out forms to the extent they don't have time to produce a product.
Right.
And I don't want to do the same thing with youth camps and boys' camps and girls' camps and set up so much red tape that volunteers have to hire a lawyer and an accountant to run a camp for 20 kids. And that's why I voted against it, and I'd like to see it succeed.
Congressman, I want to congratulate you as an old-time Democrat. At 75 years of age, I want to congratulate you for going back to the town hall meeting. I want to congratulate you for speaking the truth all the time. You just got through with a beautiful analogy of why you voted the way you did. And I want Charlie, the mayor, to commit himself that the reason why he wants the Republican convention here is because he wants the Republicans all over the country to see how you live in a Democratic country.
You know, while we're fighting our Eastern attitudes, and with that in mind, I got this letter today from Bob Creighton. I've never met him, 346 Newton Street, Westbury, New York. He writes, "Mr. Mayor, when cows and hogs get the right to vote, Kansas City sounds like a great place to hold a political convention. A few burger joints and neon signs, and right away you suffer delusions that you can take on the Big Apple. I once had the misfortune to find myself in Omaha, and they are afflicted with the same strip highway burger joint plague as Kansas City. Therefore, I must recite an old saying of my dear mother, when you've seen one hick town, you've seen them all. I only venture west of New York City when I'm assured the plane flies nonstop to California.
Mayor,
he signs it, yours in Christ.
You know,
but anyway, that's why I want to run at those guys tomorrow and announce that we brought the Republicans to Kansas City.
Let me share with you, and some of the people here have heard me say it before, which you mentioned the letter which said that we're a hick town. And I recall one of my favorite stories that I love to tell because I enjoy taking a shot at our big friends from New York City and the Big Apple. The farm boy from Missouri that went to New York City, the boy's name was Fred Hicks, and he met a banker back there by the name of James A. Cobb. And Mr. Cobb talked to the Hicks boy for a long while. And finally, son, he said, where are you from? He said, Missouri. Mr. Cobb said, you're a farm boy? He said, that's right. He said, what's your name? He said, Hicks. And he laughed so loud you could hear him all the way down to the hall. He said, son, do you know what we do with Hicks in New York City? The boy said, no, sir, but I know what we do with Cobbs back in Missouri. Tell that story in Washington, you have to explain it to them, you know that? Personally, I want to thank the mayor for being with us today and for discussing the issues with the people as he has, and want to thank you people for taking your time to come and to be with us, to join with us as we enter into a dialogue between the people that are being represented and those that are given the task of representing. I hope you can be with us next month when we will have a guest that I think you're going to enjoy and appreciate. If you can't be with us in person, and I hope you can, because these meetings are indeed open to the public. But if you can't, I hope you can join us on the more than 25 television and radio stations around the Midwest that carry dialogue with Litton. So join us next month when we again bring government to the people.
Each month, Missouri Congressman Jerry Litton invites a well-known Washington figure to come to Missouri and join him in an unrehearsed two-hour question and answer open to the public town meeting. This has been a 30-minute edited portion of this month's meeting. Dialogue with Litton is presented monthly on this station to keep you better informed about your government.